Hello and welcome to Fast Charge, the weekly smartphone podcast from the team at Tech Advisor. I am your host, Dom, joined this week by our usual crew of Toddy and Lewis, along with Aniran popping in to help cover all of the Sony stuff.
Hello.
So Sony announced flagship phones this week, and that was only the second most important launch of what's been a nice,
on the
quiet,
same day.
Slow week. Yeah, the second most launch of that very day. Sony launched the Xperia 1.4 along the Xperia 10.4. We're going to talk about them. But Google announced, I'm not even going to say what Google announced because there's so much, because we'll get to it. Google announced a lot more than we were expecting them to announce. And before that, earlier in the week, we also had the launch of the ZTE Axon 40 series, which we're going to talk about a little bit at the end. They are mostly exciting because we've got the third gen of ZTE's under display camera. So we're seeing the next step forward in that tech. A little confession at the top of the show. I was on holiday for a lot of the past week. And then I was actually out for dinner last night. So I have missed every single one of these launches and know very little about anything we're about to discuss over the next hour. So even more than normal, I will be playing the role of enthusiastic idiot, asking people who know more than me to explain in simple terms what has happened. I do know a little bit about other news from the week because I'm very good at skimming headlines and jotting like two words down in my notes to sort of rush through as we go through this. So let's do that. First off, today, one of the many, many launches this week, Realme gave a European launch to the Realme 9, to two more Realme 9 phones, I should say. We've already had some. We've got the Realme 9 and the Realme 9 5G in Europe today, along with the Realme Pad Mini, which is their dinky little Android tablet. One thing to clarify with the Realme 9s is that the Realme 9 is the Realme 9, but the Realme 9 5G is not the Realme 9 5G. By which I mean, if you've seen the Realme 9 5G in India, this is not that phone. That's a good thing because the Realme 9 5G in India was actually the Realme 8 5G. They just kind of repackaged it for another year. Whereas the Realme 9 5G for Europe is a different and new phone. And I did double check, it is not the same as the Realme 9 5G SE, which is the other India only version. So this is technically a seventh Realme 9 phone.
Yep.
But we only have six names of Realme 9 phones. It's a little odd. But for Europe, there is the 9 and the 9 5G. They're actually the exact same price in the UK, though the pricing is slightly different in Europe, but it's still very close. And really, basically, what it comes down to is the 4G model is quite a good budget option with a lot of good specs. The 5G model drops almost every single one of its specs down a peg. You know, the display is a bit worse, the chipset's a bit worse, the charging is a bit worse. Cameras are a bit worse, but it's got 5G, but it hits the same price. So you're kind of really making this very direct specs versus 5G for the same price point choice, yeah. Which is kind of interesting. They're one of the first brands to really put it that overtly in that budget space.
I think we're getting the better version of the 5G as well, my preference, like over the Indian one. Like the specs setup seems better and more kind of worthwhile for the price.
Yeah, for sure.
If you want to get technical, it's not really a whole additional eighth model, but there is also, I was looking on Realme's UK's website after today, and there's also a Free Fire version, limited edition of the Pro, the 9 Pro Plus, which is just, I think, a different back. And instead of Dare to Leap, it's Dare to Booyah as the slogan for that phone, which makes me die inside. But that's an option as well.
If you're,
yeah.
If I will never complain about Dare to Leap again.
Exactly. Hey, they didn't put it on the back though, which I'm kind of sad about. I wish they'd really committed, but yeah.
Well, that exists. Cool. Next week, things are not looking likely to slow down too much. Although, I mean, I say that next week is not quite as intense as having multiple flagship launches, but a few launches for next week. One on the 18th of May, next Wednesday, Huawei is holding a, I think what it describes as a global flagship product launch event. I think that's the wording. Still playing coy about what those are, but they have a little teaser. It looks like there's something wearably. There's kind of, you know, circular watch face looking images floating around. And there's something that looks a bit like it could be a foldable. So the smart guess is this is probably the Mate XS2, which just launched in China the other week, and we were talking about on the show. And to be honest, I think I said it's not getting a global launch. Lo and behold, 2 weeks later, it looks like it probably is. So egg on my face. Like I said, enthusiastic idiot here in full force. And yeah, some sort of watch. I lose track of Huawei's smartwatch lines, I'm going to be honest, because I never use any of them. But
there's a lot.
Yeah, I'm sure there's been one that came out in China recently and it isn't here yet. And I guess it's that one.
But yeah, the runner came out of nowhere when Lewis covered that one. But yeah, who knows what else they've got planned.
Yeah, the Huawei watch is going to launch next week, probably, along with the Mate XS2, we think. The next day, the 19th of May, next Thursday, OnePlus has yet another phone launch. I cannot quite believe how many products they have managed to launch in the first 5 months of this year. We are now getting what looks like a European launch for the OnePlus Nord 2T, which is a replacement for the Nord 2. All they've confirmed spec-wise is 80-watt charging. So it's going to replace the Nord 2. It'll be at least the same specs as the Nord 2, maybe a few upgrades. That 80-watt charging is certainly an upgrade. We're not sure how much else will change, but it looks basically like a T-series follow-up to the Nord 2, which makes sense. What that does raise the question of is when the Nord 3 is coming, because we're not far off when we would have expected the Nord 3. I think that was normally kind of June, July was when the last two main Nords came out. I'm guessing that means the Nord 3 is now later in the year than we would have thought otherwise, because the Nord 2T is still yet to come. It's also going to come alongside the CE2 Lite and the Nord Buds, which both launched in India recently. So they're now getting an international launch outside India, notably not the 10R, which also just launched in India. So yeah, complicated product lineup. Yeah.
I'm still holding out hope that the OnePlus TV actually makes it out of India at one point. I still think about that TV so much.
The pitch on the stage was extremely convincing. They made it look like the coolest damn TV, and I don't know how they did it.
And
it
was the same bar event, that drops, I think, out at the bottom. Yep. Like,
yeah. Oh, was it the same event where the watch was launched, which turned out to be terrible?
I think it might have been.
I think, yeah.
Right.
Sure. Yeah. Let's not focus on that.
I should say, if you hear a loud knock, that is the Nord Buds turning up my house. So we will at some point have a review. I don't know when. But yeah.
You might have to run away and discreetly receive a Nord Buds package. okay. So those are next week's big launches. Looking a little further afield, for fans of foldables, this has been an interesting week because the first renders have arrived from OnLeaks for both the Z Fold 4 and the Z Flip 4. You can go look those up if you want to get a look at them. There's honestly not that much to say about either, except neither phone has changed radically from the previous generation in terms of design. So if you were hoping or expecting for bigger design changes, I'm sorry, you'll be disappointed, but we do get a look at how they'll both look. We've heard some talk about new colors for the Flip 4, which we spoke about before. Dimensions have changed fractionally for the phone, but it really does look just like the Flip 3. And again, on the Fold, looks very, very, very similar, except a slightly tweaked rear camera module in line with what we'd heard about the camera tweaks there. So yeah, go look at them if you fancy, but basically the line is more of the same from last year, which I don't think is a big surprise to anyone. And then finally, a couple bits of Apple news to round us off. One, looking even further afield than these new foldables, we've had yet more sort of churn for the USB-C iPhone rumor mill. The latest speculation is that the iPhone 15, i.e. next year's iPhones, will be the first to move to a USB-C port and ditch Lightning for good, which... I'm still kind of in this, I'll believe it when I see it. Exactly. We've heard this every year for as long as I've been covering tech, I swear. And it probably will happen eventually. But until I see an iPhone with a USB-C port in it, I'm not going to believe it, I don't think.
I want it. It'll be so much easier.
Yes. Yeah. It's a good change. The fact that they've done it in so many of the iPads and everything, it probably is coming now. But yeah, yeah. I mean, everyone thought...
with MagSafe, there's less reliance on the actual Lightning connector as well, so fewer people are going to actually have the cables and stuff as time goes on.
Exactly, yeah. I think it's going to matter less and less, and especially now that they don't even give you the actual charger anymore, it kind of removes the pressure on that a little bit further. But the other Apple news this week is a long belated farewell to the iPod Touch, the last iPod, which I have to admit, I did not think they were still either making or selling iPods.
I had no idea.
So I was very surprised to see all the news stories this week announcing they discontinued the iPod. I'm sure they did that a while ago. But no, apparently the iPod Touch was still an official Apple product being supported and everything. And now they are letting remaining stock sell out. And that's it for iPods.
Oh, man.
End of an era.
I know. I mean, I haven't used an iPod in about 10 years or more, but just hearing it, I'm like, it just gets me all nostalgic about my first iPod back in the day and how cool it was, and just the click feedback of the circular control.
I never owned an iPod.
Me neither.
I had an iRiver, which was game changing at the time. It could do 15 FPS video playback if you installed the Korean ROM.
Yeah.
And the iPod Photo was out on the market, so it was
amazing.
Damn.
I had some enormous creative MP3
everyone had
it. It was one of those ones that had just, for the time, colossal amounts of storage. So 20,000 songs or something, you know. But it was built like a brick at a time when iPods were still, you know, fairly dinky, at least by comparison.
Yeah, it was a defensive weapon.
Yeah, I love that thing dearly. It had dents by the time I was finished with it. Great.
One thing the tech doesn't have enough of these days is dents.
Yeah. Okay, let's turn to the biggest news of the week, Google I.O., which took place last night. I missed all of it, I'll be honest, and I've done my best to pick through the scraps today and figure out what I missed, but I feel like there was quite a lot. So I guess the highlight really is that they, for a dev conference, they had a heavy hardware focus. And I think we'd always said beforehand, there'll be a bit of hardware, but remember, it's a software show, like, don't expect too much. And no, Google came out swinging in the other direction. So we got the Pixel 6a, the bit that we were kind of pretty confident we were going to see. We got a decent preview of the Pixel Watch, but it is coming. It is a bit further afield than the 6a, but we did actually kind of see this thing in action. We got the Pixel Buds Pro, which had been rumored pretty recently. We didn't see the Pixel Foldable. But to make up for that, we got a surprise reveal of the Pixel 7 and 7 Pro design, which I had not seen coming, and the reveal that Google is working on a Pixel tablet to round out its product ecosystem, though that one is not coming until next year. Before we get into all that, Toddy, you did watch the show. Was there anything of particular interest on the software side? I know they ran through some little bits, you know, the usual kind of new features in Maps and stuff like that. But I know in the run-up, we were talking about big announcements around Android 13 features or Wear OS, stuff like that. Did we get anything too exciting on that front?
I mean, off the top of my head, nothing stood out. Just like, yeah, Android 13, here are like the key features. I mean, Aniron, maybe you can help me out. You actually took the update on our feature on that one. That's... But yeah, I don't recall anything being like revelatory in the moment. It was just, yeah, Android 13's here. You can download the beta now, I think. That was kind of really what the biggest reveal of Android 13 was in the show, which is probably one of the most expected parts of what they had to say about it.
Mm. Yeah, I think there was very minor tweaks to like the earthquake detection thing that they were showing off and updates to Google Wallet. But these were nothing particularly significant. All the big changes, they say they were just repeating what they'd already mentioned earlier in the year.
Yeah, they're looking to bring like IDs to Google Wallet in a more meaningful way. That was like an interesting aspect of you know, a part of the Google system apps that we've not really had anyone touch on in a long, long time.
I guess they've got to catch up with Apple on all of the driving licenses.
Yeah, for sure. Right. You know, especially when Apple, I think, I don't know if it was the last dub or one prior, but when they talked about, you know, they were getting driving license, I think, and you could start your car and all of this stuff with their the iPhone stuff. Yeah, I think Google's now like playing catch up, but it was nothing groundbreaking or earth shattering in the moment. It was more just like Android 13's here, in a sense. If you want to, you can now download it,
which you could before.
Anyway. Yeah, but yeah, but now it's even, but now it's you even can more beta-y. Yeah, because the beta has progressed another stage. Now it's to the point where it's not guaranteed to destroy your phone immediately, whereas before you were really dicing with death if you wanted to make it your main phone's OS experience. So I guess there's that.
All right, so let's turn to the hardware stuff then, because I think really that's the most exciting side of last night. Let's sort of build up through, we'll end with the phones, I guess. Start with the Pixel Buds Pro, which we spoke about a bit briefly before. So they are launching in late July alongside the Pixel 6a. And they're in an interesting position. They're kind of, they're premium true wireless headphones, but they are not premium. They're $200, which sits them in this space where they're still kind of undercutting the proper high-end AirPods Pro. They're around a match for the Galaxy Buds Pro, but there are definitely more expensive true wireless pairs on the market. But yeah, I mean, it's interesting seeing Google turn their hand to a high-end pair of headphones, especially ones with active noise cancelling, which we haven't seen Google do before. And I'm very curious to see how they can pull that off, because it's new to them. But equally, it's exactly the kind of machine learning driven feature that Google could just come out and nail first time.
Yeah, they talked about they've got this new 6-core, I guess, dedicated chipset. I don't think it's like a successor to anything we've already seen in the existing Pixel Buds line.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of how their ANC algorithm is going to be kind of powered effectively, hardware-wise. I've not heard anyone like sing the praises of Pixel Buds in terms of audio quality.
No.
So I'm very curious to see whether that actually takes a stat, like that's actually part of why these buds are worthwhile. Otherwise, the only kind of angle I see is that, like with the existing ones, it's just the convenience of having a Google Pixel branded device that works well with most Android phones, especially Pixel phones.
Yeah. And that's clearly why they make them to some extent. And, you know, nothing is more telling, I think, than the fact that we've had a lot of the press imagery Google has been showing around for I/O has been all of the hardware together. You know, that's the stuff it wants to push. It's not, here's some phones, here's a tablet, here's some headphones. It's, here's the Google ecosystem together. Don't you want to be someone who owns all of these lovely Google products at once, and how nicely they're going to work together? Because that's obviously always been Apple's play, and Samsung has lent very hard into that space over the past few years. Huawei obviously had been as well. And we're slowly seeing a lot of the rivals build out in that space as much as they can. But Google has always been a bit half in, half out on that proper ecosystem space. And this feels like a return to that, not least when you take it together with the tablet announcement. Because again, this is a space where we've spoken about Android tablets and they're coming back, and bemoan the fact that one of the things that's always held them back is there hasn't been a Google one for a while, you know? So Google makes the software, but it wasn't bothering with its own tablet hardware, which made it a lot harder for OEMs, because there was clearly not a big internal Google push that tablets mattered.
It's really hard. I mean, we can get into the tablet a bit more, not that there was a huge amount to talk about, but it's hard right now. Like the original Pixel Buds, the software experience wasn't very good. And then I think they kind of rectified it when they went to the true wireless ones and the Pixel Buds A, but the kind of the hype had gone. People weren't like as like excited about those buds. The history of their tablets, you know, back when they did Nexus tablets, they were pretty much loved. I think Nexus 7 was
my
one
Nexus
of, like,
7.
Everyone loved the Nexus 7. Then they made the Pixel branded Android tablets way back when. There was the Pixel C, and I think there might have been another one. They were terrible. So the hardware looked great, but when you used it, it was awful, and it was a buggy mess. And so I am super apprehensive about another Pixel tablet. And in terms of ecosystem right now, you know, the Pixel 6 series, they said it's our best selling Pixel phones to date. But also, this is maybe more than any Pixel phone I can think of in recent memory. The number of bugs that users have been hitting. Again, it's the software. Like the hardware seems solid, but the software was really bad. And that's the issue that they had with their their tablets as well. And I'm really concerned in terms of ecosystem, the reliability of things like Pixel Buds switching between devices and stuff.
Yeah.
That's my huge concern right now.
If it's not seamless and easy and everything, then the ecosystem doesn't matter. Because the only pitch for buy the Google version is it will work perfectly with all the other Google things you own. So if it doesn't, then well, you might as well just have AirPods together with your Google phone, because it's going to be just as awkward. But yeah, I think you've hit the nail on the head in terms of the track record here. For both tablets and headphones, they are hit and miss, would be generous, maybe.
Yeah.
We've had a comment on YouTube from Henry Burrell, who's actually our current phones editor, who couldn't join the show this week, but he will hopefully be with us next week. But he wanted to chime in because he hates the Pixel Buds so much. And just wanted to let us all know that the OG Pixel Buds are the worst product I have ever reviewed.
Wow.
I think I'm kind of remember with this. The second remember, gen ones as well.
Yeah, just, I remember working with Henry when he was reviewing the Pixel Buds. They hurt his ears to use, from right. what I remember. Wow. They're just painful and awful. And
well,
yeah.
The design looks just like, bring it back to the pros, the design looks identical. I don't know if the drives are bigger or anything like that. I don't know like the finer points of like the internals, but the design looks identical to the one we've seen from the last two sets of True Wireless that they've done.
Yeah.
In some nice colors. Again, they look familiar colors. I don't think there's any new colors. They seem to be informed by the current Pixel range.
Yeah.
More than like what they were teasing later on in the show. Yeah, so
I like the look of them. And to be fair, I know we've not been huge fans of Pixel Buds, but I've spoken to other tech journalists who really liked the most recent Pixel Buds. I don't know that anyone liked the originals, but the more recent ones, I do know some people who were big fans of those. So I don't want to sound like too down on them, but yeah, there's got to be big question marks around how the Pixel Buds Pro perform. And then yeah, those same question marks about the tablet. The tablet I'm a little thrown by, because Google are pitching this, they haven't said much. They've said they're designing a tablet, it's going to come out in 2023, and they've shown a brief look at the design and spoken a little bit about it. And the kind of things they're saying are big screen and premium. When you look at it, it's got quite a thick bezel around the edge. The it back looks like it's got a plastic back. They haven't sort of confirmed material, but it certainly looks like it's a kind of thick, curved plastic finish.
If you take the Google Nest Hub and just pull the screen off the speaker, it's kind of that.
Yeah, exactly.
That's what it looks like.
And it looks fine if that was meant to be a $200 or $300 tablet. You know, which, I'd say, cool. If this is meant to be a base iPad competitor, I'd be like, perfect. Yeah, fine. I don't know if I like the look of it as much as, say, the Xiaomi Pad 5, but it's not that far off. It looks kind of googly, so cool. But it sounds like this is more like an iPad Air or even an iPad Pro. And I mean, we don't know enough about it, but it doesn't look like that, does it? It doesn't look like on the design level they're keeping up.
It's funny as well, because when you think about the design of the iPad Pro, that does have quite thick bezels, but they just somehow look worse on the Google tablet. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's because they're white bezels.
The white doesn't help. Yeah.
It does not look good.
And I think also just coming into, we whenever we do talk about the tablet market, the iPads kind of have their own bubble, and expectations are defined by other iPad stuff. They're not really defined by any other competitors, not really even Surface, which is kind of a weird halfway house beast type thing to compare them against. I only really feel like Samsung's earned its place to produce premium tablets. They built up to it, they've always had a tablet presence. And then only more recently have we got things like I think from the S7, they really got serious about Tab S7 making like premium slates. And obviously this year we had the SA Ultra. I feel like Google coming in cold to that market, and when they had this spotty track record, is a really concerning move in my mind. And I think they should, like you said, I think 300 is like the max that people should be expecting to pay. They can go premium with their phones because the camera tech is so good, but that's the one aspect that you don't need to worry about on a tablet. Not really. You want a good front camera, but like, you're not going to
Google's strengths don't obviously come into play here.
So don't go premium, Google. Rein it in.
Samsung must be fuming. Samsung have single-handedly propped up the Android tablet market for the best part of a decade with no thanks, and just constant criticism from the media still being like, oh, Android tablets, they suck, and even still Samsung, everyone just being like, Android tablets suck, the only people who make them are Samsung, they suck too. Google pops in once every 4 years, tries one, goes, nah, tablets are too hard, we're not going to bother for a while. And so for Google to now say, oh, actually, we're finally going to do a tablet version of Android, and oh, we're finally building a tablet, you know, we're going to swan in and dominate this space. Samsung must just be like looking at them thinking, what, you absolutely...
There's something about Android tablets. It's the same problem that I feel like streaming service UIs have and smart TV UIs. It's like, there's obviously work that needs to be done to make them good, but no one seems to know, including me, how to make them good. But everyone can see that they're bad, but no one really knows how to make them good. And I feel like that's Android tablets all over. Like, obviously we know there's underlying issues with Android and the big screen in Android L, which apparently is available, sort of addresses that. But even with Samsung's efforts, it's still not cracked. And I don't think I have confidence in Google to crack it with this tablet.
Yeah, absolutely not.
I imagine, like, as we've seen with like the influx of companies making tablets again, that they all go for this, or at least start at the budget end and then would be slowly building it. But I imagine Google is thinking, we can put a real statement out there with our first tablet in years. And I imagine, I know there were some people were speculating whether there'll be like keyboard accessories. So whether Google will think, it can be like the Tab S8 Ultra, it can be a proper laptop replacement. It's going to, and I think it'll be very dangerous for it to start making such big claims early on before it's established its Pixel tablet brand again.
Yeah, I think it needs to learn from the success of its A phones and play in that space with tablets, at least for the first one, and just kind of prove it works. Or in the way that even the Pixel 6 and 6 Pro are kind of affordable premium. You know, they're flagships, but they're still kind of undercutting the competition a little bit. Hopefully when Google say premium, that's kind of what they mean. Still coming in a little cheaper than Samsung and cheaper than Apple's top offerings. But we'll see. This is a long way off. So tablet next year. Let's talk about the watch, which we didn't know how much watch we were going to get to watch. We thought they might tease it. They might, you know, just show us, you know, one watch face. They might do a full OS reveal without talking about the hardware. And in fact, at least coming from the perspective of an outside observer just catching up everything today, I feel like we learned a lot more about the watch than I maybe expected to going into the event. Is that fair?
Yeah, I'd say so. I think there was just a couple of little admissions that I thought were interesting. Like the design has leaked pretty extensively and it was verified. You know, those leaks were on the money. It's this domed kind of black half on the front and then polished steel, stainless steel on the back. It's recycled stainless steel. The thing I think that was already kind of talked about in rumors and leaks was whether it's proprietary straps. It is. Mm-hmm. And they latch on, they kind of snap in and then you twist it to lock them in place. It looks like quite a cool design. So that's one thing you've got to kind of come to terms with if you're hoping for your own straps going on a Pixel watch. And the other thing was, for me at least, was how Fitbit played into the whole thing. Mm-hmm. And they had on the main screen of the watch they were showing on the presentation has a Fitbit widget or tile, if you will, as part of Wear OS that is for activity tracking and sleep tracking and all sorts. So Fitbit is properly coming to Wear OS and it's going to be initially exclusive to the Pixel watch. So that was an interesting move. And there are a few other tidbits about Wear OS. There's now speculation because there's only been one leaked image that suggests it's not called Wear OS 3 anymore. It's going to be Wear OS 3.1 for the Pixel watch. I don't know if that's exclusive to the Pixel watch or if that's what all the other watches when they get updated later this year are going to run. It's unclear. They still didn't say. They just called it Wear.
The naming and the versioning on all of this has been so messy. No one has any idea what to call this software.
Yeah.
Or even, you know, it's still not clear almost a year later whether Wear OS 3 is already out on the Galaxy Watch 4 or whether it's not out and we're still waiting for it to arrive on the Pixel Watch. Like, technically speaking, is it already here or not? I don't really have an answer to that.
What do you guys think of the watch though, from what you saw? Like,
I have to say, I really like, I haven't seen a lot, I haven't dug deep into the functionality, but the design I love. And I'm not a smartwatch guy. I don't really enjoy wearing or reviewing them. I try and avoid them if I can. And when I review one, I'll review it. And then I very rarely keep it on my wrist for longer than I have to. And I don't know that I like this enough that that would change that, but I do really like how it looks. I like the fact that it is unashamedly a bit of kind of smart hardware. It's obviously taking inspiration from watches, but it's not trying to look like an analog watch. It has its own look. But I like the fact that it's round. I like the fact they seem to be making that work in the UI space, and it just looks so clean and simple, and you know, this sort of single curved pebble of glass kind of look to it that really works for me, at least.
Yeah, it has a rotating crown. I think they don't think they call it a haptic crown, or they think they call it a tactile crown. Mm-hmm. So that gives you crown. Some, yeah, not digital, but it's tactile, so it will have some level of feedback, I feel. Is what that means. And yeah, the silicon straps, like the whole thing kind of makes sense. It feels decidedly like in the same school of design as what we've seen mainly from the Nest stuff, actually, maybe more so than it looks kind of like a mini Nest thermostat in a way, more so than like a Pixel phone, which I thought was quite interesting. The thing I did notice was the crown, and I noticed it went partly into the black curved front, so I was like, okay, how much of that is actually display? And the display, when you see it lit up, isn't actually that big. There's quite a sizable bezel, basically anywhere it curves along the edge.
Yeah.
So that's something to bear in mind. If you're the people
watching on YouTube right now, I've got a picture up where you can see there's a couple, the image on the left and the image on the right, you can actually see at the bottom where the bezel starts because the picture gets cut off and the notification gets cut off. So yeah, it is fairly chunky.
The screen is not that big.
Yeah, that's fair.
We didn't get any specs on like how big that screen is or how big the casing is or anything like that. We did see Rick Osterley, who's like head of product, I think, who's a pretty big guy, he's pretty tall. He had one on his wrist on stage, which he kind of just pulled back his jacket to reveal, which was a slick reveal. But on him, it looked like...
Tiny?
No, it didn't look that tiny to me. I think it's bigger than I was expecting.
Oh, interesting. Because the image make it look quite small, don't they?
But yeah, I think he's got like broader wrists than I've got, pretty dainty wrists. So I reckon on me it'll look kind of huge. But yeah, be curious to see it like in person and kind of get a feel for just how big it really is.
I wonder if Google will ever, maybe not with this first generation, but to have two different sizes. Because I imagine that's something they'll be building towards at least.
Yeah. I mean, there might actually be already two sizes. Because in that main image I just showed, the one in the middle, I mean, it's probably just camera angles, but the one in the middle is bigger than the other two.
Yeah, it is, because they did say, I think when they first admitted they were working on a watch in 2018, they said, we're not looking for a one-size-fits-all solution. But if there is one casing size, it is sort of a one-size-fits-all solution.
What you're doing. Yeah, quite literally.
Yeah.
I guess, the other interesting, I guess it comes down to price as well here, whether I imagine they'll be undercutting like the Apple Watch, the Galaxy Watches, but where they position this is interesting in terms of whether they want it to be ultra affordable, a good entry point into the world of Pixel wearables, or if they want to push it and claim it's like a proper full computer on your wrist, kind of like the Apple Watch does.
When now it's been made real, I'm wondering, like, does this open the door for down the line a Pixel Watch A?
Maybe.
Oh yeah,
what would that look like?
I imagine they'll be pushing this one in the 200 to 300 range. Basically very Apple similar Watch. To the Galaxy Watch. I think a bit below the Apple Watch.
Yeah.
Around the Galaxy Watch. I think they'll look at exactly where Samsung placed theirs and say, that's a pretty good spot to be where they still get to have that. We're cheaper than Apple. But you don't want to go too cheap, because then, you know, this is them doing their first proper smartwatch kind of thing. They want to convince you it's quality, not a budget thing. And you know, you can do that in this space without going too expensive, where it's the sake, and where this is a parallel to what we were saying with tablets earlier, but the difference is with tablets, premium means close to a grand, whereas premium can mean a few hundred.
To say this dictates price, but like, as they didn't talk about hardware leaks suggest, like, it's, if there is a cellular model, it'll use a Samsung modem, so whatever the LTE modem is in the Galaxy Watch 4 is probably the same one that would so that has like a base cost that would sort of inform where this is going to be headed price wise. There's also speculation as to whether they've worked on their own, maybe not Tensor, but their own chipset for this, or whether it's just using the same, I think it's the Exynos W920, which is what's in the Galaxy Watch 4 again. Considering they talked about that partnership with Samsung last year, and that was how they built it, I reckon it's underneath. It's the Galaxy Watch 4. That's my guess.
What will be interesting, I guess, is on that note, whether it's closer to the Galaxy Watch 4 or the Galaxy Watch 5.
Mm.
Because when this, you know, what we know is this is coming in autumn. Well, by then, we probably expect to see the Galaxy Watch 5 in August, I guess.
I reckon.
So by then, we'll probably have Samsung's next gen. Samsung will have released two Wear OS 3 watches before Google gets its first one out. From what we're expecting right now. So yeah, with how long this has been in development, based on what we know from leaks, there is this worry that actually, in terms of the underlying hardware, it might be closer to Samsung's year old model than it is to the Samsung model that launches at the same time.
Yeah. And at the same time, Wear OS 3 supposedly won't really run properly on devices that don't have a Snapdragon Wear 4100 or newer, which that's the newest one that the Snapdragon range offers right now. So like anything from like last year, Wear OS 3 won't properly run on it. And also you have to reset your device to factory to install it. Apparently this is what we've been told. So yeah, still a mess, even though we now know more about it.
We also we finally got like a little bit more word on the Google Assistant coming to the Galaxy Watch 4s. But even then, we just still essentially got more confirmation that, yeah, it's still coming soon. And they've basically been saying that since last August and still failing to actually get the Assistant on the Galaxy Watch 4. But yeah, we still have so many questions about the Pixel Watch, but my initial impression is pretty positive. But with that disclaimer that I have no vested interest in smartwatches, so...
Yeah, I like how it looks. I think it's got a heart rate sensor on the back, which makes sense. I hope the battery's good.
I'm just here for a notification integration. Better notification integration. That was one of the key things of all Android watches that I hate compared to the Apple Watch, is that it's just there's that lack of synchronicity between the two. So I'm hoping this very changes messy. That.
The other thing to note with the Fitbit integration is that depending on what we see from Fitbit, this could very easily launch and immediately be the best Fitbit smartwatch. Yeah. Which is a pretty low bar to clear.
This is the first non-Fitbit branded wearable to offer Fitbit tracking on your wrist, which is kind of a huge deal for Fitbit as a brand.
Exactly. Which
they didn't really touch on. So it has huge implications for the future of Fitbit's other like line of trackers existing and forthcoming. And they talked about it just seems very odd. It's an odd move. It makes sense because Google owns Fitbit as of the start of last year, but the Fitbit fans, I don't know if this is something they're actually excited about. I feel like this is not what they would be wanting. They'd just want another sensor, another Versa or whatever.
It really cracks the door for that Fitbit ecosystem that's been very tightly controlled with all those subscriptions and everything and starts opening questions of how
I think
that
it
works.
Makes sense as to why there is a subscription now, because they're going to start putting their stuff on hardware that's not theirs and they still need to make money off it somehow. So subscriptions.
And I'm sure, again, we'll have to see what happens down the line, but I'm sure at least for a while we'll still see the sort of the more impressive health sensing stuff on the latest sensors and Versas to say be tied to the next gen Fitbit hardware. So, and some of those subscription features to be tied to that hardware. So there is still at least some for the real Fitbit devotees. There's still a kind of like, well, you don't get the best sensing unless you get the official Fitbit.
Yeah.
But if you just want your step tracking, and heart rate sensing to connect to your Fitbit account, you can get that on other hardware. But we'll see. All right, let's turn to phones, because we've already gone half an hour on Google without even talking about either of the phones. Let's talk Pixel 7 first, because there's a lot less to say there. Am I correct in saying they just showed off what the Pixel 7 and 7 Pro look like?
Which I wasn't expecting.
None of us were expecting. I was very confused. I genuinely, when I was seeing some of the reporting, I was like, I thought there were typos on some of the sites I was seeing. So they were like, Google reveals Pixel 7. I was like, these buffoons, imbeciles, you know, they don't know what they're writing about. And then look, no, okay, they have actually gone to reveal that. So we have design of the 7 and the 7 Pro, new color range, some tweet colors. And now that camera bar has these kind of metallic tones. And these cutouts for the cameras. So on the 7, it's a kind of oval cutout, and the Pro gets an oval and a circle. I have to admit, we'd seen this design leaked, but you know, this is now the official reveal. My immediate thought on seeing Google has decided to reveal this now is to try and get ahead of the iPhone 14 Pro series so that it looks like Apple's punch holes have copied Google's camera bar rather than the other way around. I was going to say that,
It looks exactly
the exact design everyone says we're going to see on the 14 Pros punch hole cameras. The pill and the punch next to each other.
Right.
And now it's Google's design first.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Fascinating. What do you guys think about the visor? Or now, I kind of want to call it the bracelet now, because it's the metal frame now runs through that band across the back, and it's just cutouts for the cameras, where whereas it's glass on the Pixel 6 series.
I think it looks better than the Pixel 6. I don't know. I didn't like the glass.
Yeah.
I think the metal is kind of more reassuring as I place it down on a hard surface. It's not gonna matter.
I really wasn't sure, like tonally, like whether it was the right call. I thought it looked a bit funny, and I'd seen leaked cases like just before, which just had cutouts for those camera elements, and they look weird to me as well. But I think the more I look at it, the more I like it.
I like it, but with the caveat that I think said several times in the show, I don't like the look of the Pixel 6 series. I don't really like the look of these either. I just like them a bit more. Yeah. I still broadly think, as a design choice, the camera bar and everything just does not work for me. And it's not grown on me over time. But I think this is a slight refinement of it for me.
Yeah. My only kind of positive on the camera bar is that it's distinct. That doesn't necessarily mean it's nice, but it's distinct. So you can recognize a pixel from a mile off. This softens that a bit by having this gold bar instead of this like prominent black bar. But yes, it is more elegant, I would say.
Yeah, it looks more premium.
Is that only in gold, the metalwork, from what we've seen?
No, there are sort of silvery versions. Yeah. And on the black model, I'm not sure if it's just the lighting.
Yeah.
On the black model, it looks like the metal is darker, like more graphite-y.
It does, yeah.
Which is
true, like a space gray rather metal. Than a silver. Yeah. Right. But I'm not. It might just be that one of those optical illusion things where it's because of the surrounding color. And if you put them next to each other, I'd reveal, you know, they'd be the exact same, maybe.
Oh, I love color science.
I have to say, I don't particularly like. I think they called it lemongrass. This really light.
Yeah.
Green. I'm not sure that the bar doesn't. I don't particularly like that.
I don't like the bar contrast. Yeah,
how the two clash.
Yeah, right. But the actual kind of. Like lem sippy color, I quite like. Ew. I think
I'm never not going to make that association, but that's the lem.
Okay, so Pixel 7, we know it's getting a design overhaul. What overhaul's too strong? A design adjustment.
Tweak.
The only thing that's many things that are funny about this announcement and it coming like months ahead of the phone's launch is odd. What makes it doubly odd, and this is just so Google, is this kind of thing of announcing the new design for the Pixel 7 at the same time as they reveal the 6A, which does not have this design language.
It does not.
And they literally did the same thing last year, so I don't know why we're surprised about this anymore.
It has a little nod. If you look at the camera bar real close on the 6A, it does have an oval cutout in the shiny black.
Oh, it does, really? Yeah.
Which... like this is a continuous piece of glass over the top of all the cameras, whereas on the A there is actually a little oval kind
I'm
of like etching.
Zoom
line.
In to an image. Yeah,
there is a good shot. One of the press images has a good clear shot of it.
Okay.
So it's sort of like a transitionary element, but unless you know to look for it, you wouldn't see it.
Mm-hmm.
Also, just quickly back on the sevens, they didn't show any photos of the front of the phone, so you have no idea if the bezels are any better. Because I'd say the bezels are pretty bad on the regular Pixel 6. They're pretty hefty.
Yeah.
And they are hefty on the 6A as well, I would say.
There's also been some speculation about an under-display camera.
And that as well.
7, or at least in the 7 Pro. And this, you know, we have had nothing to confirm or deny that. But 6A is launching late July. 28th of July is the on-sale date, I believe. Same time as the Buds Pro, as we were talking about earlier.
Mm-hmm.
And it is $449, £399, at least for the starting price. There may end up being like other storage options and stuff like that. As we said, it looks a lot like the 6 series, which I think is, you know, we've said what we said about that design. I think it's good to bring it in line. It's certainly a more interesting design than, say, the 5A last year, which was very, very dull looking, for better or worse.
Yeah.
The big upgrade here, obviously, other than the design changes, it's got the Tensor chip. So now we have an A series Pixel with the exact same chipset as the flagships, much like Apple does with the iPhone SE, using the same chip as the iPhone 13s. So that puts us in an interesting space from the get-go, because I think it's fair to say, in terms of sort of core phone usage, you know, what you think when you think about like benchmarking for gaming and stuff, Tensor is behind, say, the Snapdragon 8 Gen 1. Whether its machine learning prowess, you know, compensates in other spaces is up for debate, but it's not quite as powerful as the 8 Gen 1 for, say, pure gaming, though it's not far off.
Yeah.
But even so, put that chip in a $450 phone and it's going to look a lot more powerful than almost everything else around it, with a few exceptions, but not too many. And certainly, say, I was moaning about the Galaxy A53 on the show a couple of weeks ago, and that really not having performance I was happy with. This, around the same price, should really blast past what the Samsung model offers.
Yeah, I think the pricing of the Pixel 6 is already really strong for what it offers with that killer camera and the Tensor. So this is, I mean, this is going to be, especially in the US, it's going to be a hugely powerful device, I think, because of what else it's going up against. It's just not a lot out there at that price point that's going to hit as hard as this.
Yeah.
It's really strong.
I did find it unusual that there's, I know they've done this before, but there's only one configuration with 6 gigs of RAM and 128 of storage. It feels like they would need something a bit more generous, and because I imagine that's not enough for most people.
But they want you to sign up for Google Cloud Storage.
Google One.
You forget.
Yeah.
You should, you know, as I say that as a, you know, as a Google One subscriber for several years. But they absolutely, Google of all people will, I think, take that line that now everything should be in the cloud as long as it's enough space for your apps. And to be fair, I think they're probably right for most people, and especially at this mid-range segment where it's maybe less likely. The only real exception to that is people who want to install a lot of big games. And this isn't really the phone that you buy if that's your focus. So I kind of get it. And I think it simplifies their manufacturing pipeline and stuff like that, and all their pricing messaging, which I get. Yeah. If anything, I've always been a bit surprised Apple hasn't done the same in lowering its storage SKUs, at least on, say, the non-pro models and stuff like that.
I think they took so long to actually increase them that they can't catch the flack now. They shipped so many iPhones with like 16 gig of storage when everyone else was on 64. They were like, everyone else was like, come on, you can't do this anymore. Like,
I'd love to see the stats on the breakdown of which models ship with which storage configurations in, like, you know, the sales of each storage for different iPhones. Anyway, yeah, so this looks very much like a Pixel mid-ranger, which is to say it has basically the same design as the Pixel flagship. The nice thing this year is it's got performance to match, which hasn't always been true. Cameras will basically have this weird thing where the camera hardware isn't as good, but it's got all the same image processing because it's got the same chip, and so it should still be really, really good. And it's Google, so like we get with Samsung and Apple, charging is a bit meh. It's got 18 watt wired charging, which, you know, it's fine, but nothing special. Battery life is probably going to be fine, but nothing special.
That would be underwhelming, but the charging, the narrative of charging on the Pixel 6 and 6 Pro is already such a mess that it's not actually that different. Like, unless you buy the Pixel charger, any other charger is probably going to be slow anyway. So,
But 5G and the other nice touch is IP67, which, again, still a relative rarity in that price, but it's an interesting point because it, again, makes it clear that Google is taking the same approach here that Apple and Samsung have, which is kind of thinking about the kind of specs they're focusing on in this mid-range segment is those kind of, you know, reassuring niceties like an IP rating, and delivering key specs where they can say, this is just like our flagships. You know, that kind of no compromise messaging, and hoping you don't notice the other areas where they've compromised a lot.
Not necessarily that this has to be the jumping off point, but it's also something that previous, the I think Mark 2 and Mark 3 Xperia 10s in their kind of £300-ish price point area that they inhabited, they were like the only phones with OLED displays and water resistance.
Yeah.
And that was their selling point, I think. Yeah. So the Pixel 6a is doing much the same in that regard, and that's really nice.
Yeah.
The smaller display, it's because it's 6.1.
I was about to say that could be a big selling point. I think so many people, I mean, who knows, with small phones it's gone, we talk a lot about the appeal, but it doesn't get matched by sales figures.
It doesn't matter.
Anecdotally, I knew lots of people who are Pixel users who were disappointed that the 6 is as big as it is, and that there was no small version in the 6 line. And I could imagine a lot of people looking at the 6A and saying, hey, you know what? It looks like the others. It's got the same chip. Cameras are still going to be really good, but maybe not as good. And it's a smaller phone. Like, I'll just buy this one because it's smaller.
It's going to look chunky, I think, because it's the same thickness.
Yes.
So despite having smaller height and width, it's going to have the same thickness as the other two. So, or at least the regular Pixel 6. So it's going to be a chunky looking phone, I think.
And I don't think they reveal weight, but I would wager it will be a bit hefty because of that. Not really heavy.
Considering
but,
its screen size, yeah. Probably be quite one of the heavier phones. And also, again, I think it has the bezels of the 6, pretty much like same sort of thickness of bezel.
They look similar.
Yeah, sure. It's not the most elegant device, but I think it hits a really good price point.
Has Google ever made the most elegant device?
Okay. I mean, the Nexus 5 was kind of amazing. It wasn't necessarily the prettiest phone around, but it was a great device. And I loved the Nexus, was it the 6P, which Huawei made?
The 6P, yes.
Loved something. It was huge for the time, but that design.
No, I mean, you know, I've often owned Google phones. I had a Nexus. I had a couple of Nexus phones, I think, and I already said I had the tablet. I'm a fan of a lot of their hardware, even though they do get it wrong a lot of the time as well. But I know elegance is not necessarily what I associate with Google's design language. They tend to be a little chunky and clunky, but I don't mind that about them. But it's the space they've
Google
occupied. Yeah. They're good at other stuff.
Do you know the Boba Kiki psychological test?
No.
It's like, which one of those is sharp and which one is round? Boba or Kiki?
Boba's round.
Yeah, Boba's round. Yeah.
Everyone says Boba's round and Kiki is sharp, right? Even though you have no idea what the shape is that's associated with that word. I feel like the current design language that Google's applying, especially to these products, is Boba. It's like, it feels like that word.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Am I right in thinking that the under-display fingerprint sensor is new to the A series?
Oh, yes. Yeah. It was on the back, like the fire. Yeah,
yeah. I was diving into the specs to see that one.
I mean, it's a huge pain point for most Pixel 6 and 6 Pro users.
I was saying, I'm not necessarily a good
So it's a bold choice, really. Like, here's the speed. Like, it's not too bad. But it's definitely slower than most other phones. Yeah. Google says it's for security. Maybe by
Google's
then.
Lying.
Yeah, Google's lying. They're just like, yeah. With all the other issues that the Pixel software currently has, I hope that that's addressed even more so. They already have sped it up once.
Yeah.
But by the time the 6A launches in, was it June or July?
End of July. So they've given themselves a full month and a half.
They got time to work address on that. Yeah.
Which, again, is interesting. They're not quite ready to sell it yet. And it's funny because you then kind of think, oh, well, the 6A is the one they're launching now and everything else is coming later in the year. And then you're kind of like, well, actually, hang on, the 6A is coming at the end of July, at which point it's only then a couple months.
Like a month and
before
a half.
before we get the watch and the 7, probably. So they're not as far apart as it seems, actually, because of the delay here. But anyway, let's move on and talk about the other stuff because we've done so much of the show on Google and we do need to talk about poor Sony, who this is no comment on the quality of phones, but what on earth were they thinking announcing their new phones on the same day as IO? I cannot comprehend the decision there. Google IO has had that date in the sand for months. And why would you look at the calendar and say, oh, yeah, like one of our biggest rivals is announcing new phones that day. We'll go for the exact same day to make a kind of underwhelming, we've just tweaked a couple things from last year, phone announcement, while Google are going to go and unveil a whole slate of new hardware.
You could say in a vacuum, the specs of the One Mark III were already so good that they just made the upgrades they needed to make to keep it timely, like a new chipset.
Yeah.
And that is what they've done, with maybe one sort of exception in the camera zoom feature, which we can get onto. But yeah, also, like, Sony doesn't really sell in the US, so I kind of understand.
Where do they sell, Holly?
I mean, Japan, super well. Like,
oh, yeah,
they are,
that's very well.
They're quizzing in Japan. They do okay in Europe when they're available, but they're like...
You've got your diehard Sony fans, don't you? They're just
that's kind of it, really.
Yeah, and then there's everybody else.
yeah, but like the fact that the someone is at the front door. Oh, that's the butt. I can't get it, so I think my wife will hopefully be able to do that. The availability, yeah. They also set the launch for like 8 a.m. our time, which means everyone in the US is asleep.
Yeah,
so like
they're really not going to hit many like publications.
But again, I guess they presumably were just picking the best time for the Japanese market, and I guess maybe that's what they cared about. You know, it was a global launch, and they put it Japan first, and maybe that does make sense for them. So yeah, as you alluded to, they've really taken the One Mark III and not changed a whole lot. The design is basically the same. I mean, fundamentally, they've upgraded the chipset.
Yep.
And they've upgraded the selfie camera and the zoom camera. Yeah. And that's basically it. I'm sure there's other little tweaks here and there. Yeah. But the real core, what's changed this year, it's chipset, selfie camera, zoom camera. The struggle I have is they've given it a price hike at the same time.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe that when
I saw
that. And
the One Mark III was already overpriced. And this is more expensive. So this is now... in the UK, it's £1,300. It's 1,400 euros.
Yeah.
And in the US, it's $1,600. Start price.
The US has double the storage. That's the only kind of caveat to that.
It's half a terabyte of storage in the US, but that's the only SKU. It's Sony, mad. And you know, I guess they've just decided their niche is every spec under the sun. And will be expensive, and we won't sell a lot of them. But for the people who are Sony diehards, they'll just be like, "This is the best spec phone I can buy, and I can afford to buy it."
Yeah.
And go. And as you said, they hadn't left themselves a lot of room after last year because the One Mark III was also incredibly highly spec'd. You know, it matched
and it
or
delivers,
beat almost like, every rival on every core spec.
It wasn't hype; it did deliver. They I remember because I reviewed the Mark III, like one of the big pain points, that excellent display, 4K HDR AMOLED 120 hertz, amazing, 21:9. They've doubled the brightness, so it does a peak brightness that's twice as bright as before, which that was a huge issue for that display.
Yeah,
and when Sony's done 4K screens, they've always struggled with that on phones, so it's nice to know that was the thing they focused on. And yeah, performance was already really, really good. They've just kept it in step with the rivals. I genuinely was more excited about the front camera upgrade than the back camera thing, because the selfies on a phone, that camera is such a huge part of it. The selfies have always been rubbish.
So what is the upgrade here? So I know what they have now is a 12 megapixel sensor.
Yeah, it's a physically larger sensor, which I think based on the rendered imagery, the press image is showing like the sensor kind of, they did a sort of x-ray shot on their website. It does look like the bezel might be thicker at the top as well to allow for that bigger sensor, which will be interesting to see if that's the case. But yeah, they've got a bigger lens, bigger sensor. It means you can shoot, I think, 4K 60 on the front and HDR on the front, which I don't think you could do before. Or if you did, it was rubbish because everything from that camera was rubbish. So selfies are going to be better. I think that's good that they've actually done that. Shall I talk about the rear as well, the rear camera upgrade?
Because
it's still a trio of 12 meg sensors.
Yeah.
The cool thing they introduced last year was that they had one lens, one sensor, but it could do two focal lengths.
Yep.
I can't remember what the magnification, it was like 3 and 4.4 times or something.
I think that's right, 3 and 4.4. Yeah.
So like the S21 and S22 Ultra having two zoom lengths that are optically zoomed. Here though, they've added in the ability to move between those optically, which is insane in a phone. That's amazing.
Yes.
That's
so cool.
Like having a telescopic zoom lens, but sideways inside the phone's body. It's no thicker than the last phone. It's actually a gram lighter than the last phone somehow as well. So it's an impressive technical feat, as was last year's camera system for that alone.
Yeah.
And it means, you can zoom from the ultra wide straight through to max. And that middle section is all optical. And that's really cool.
I mean, that's one of those, again, I guess it's so telling about who they're talking to, because you talk to someone who knows phones and knows camera tech and they'll go, wow, what? How'd they do that? Yeah. That's so cool. It's continuous optical, incredible. You talk to the everyday person and say, oh, it's got continuous zoom from 3.5 to 5 times. And they're like, my phone already does that. I can go between those.
It really
upsets. And you say, no, but this time it's all optical. It's all the lens.
It's,
and they're like,
digital,
what do you mean? I could do it before I zoomed it, went from one to the other.
When I see people just pinching in before they've taken the photo, I'm like, you can just do it afterwards and you'll have more pixels to play
so
with.
Much
like,
better.
Just don't do it.
But how do they possibly communicate this spec to a general audience that does not understand what they're, and I don't want to downplay what they've done because it's so cool.
Yeah.
But it just speaks to who their market are. They are trying to hit the people who you describe that, and they immediately know what they've achieved how impressive it is. And they must recognize that they are not going to appeal to the bigger audience, who will broadly, you'd think, be more impressed by Samsung saying, our Zoom goes all the way to 100,
yeah.
you know, which yeah, sounds to the layperson like yeah. a bigger achievement, right?
Yeah. I mean, if we're talking about like, yeah, appealing to Sony fans, like, should we talk Music Pro?
Yeah, go through. Mm. I have absolutely no idea what that is. So, okay. You know, me over.
Anyone else got Music Pro or shall I take it?
No,
go for it.
Okay. So it's explicitly, I looked at all the kind of caveats around it, but you know, they already had Video Pro, Cinema Pro, and Photo Pro for their camera experience.
I don't want to dwell on it, but I still hate this Video Pro and Cinema Pro, and there's different things. But
oh, and you can shoot video in Photo Pro, by the way.
Yes, I know. Those apps make it extra messy.
But now they have Music Pro. Great. What's that? It's you can use the on-device microphones. I can't remember. I think it's 3, maybe more. Just like the regular microphones that are just built into the phone. You can record yourself singing, and this is a feature explicitly for vocal, like for singing, not for recording your guitar or anything. Mm-hmm. And if you pay a subscription, a monthly subscription of $4.99, I don't know what the UK price is, you can have it sent off to a cloud storage, and it can be mastered using cloud processing to make it close to a professional condenser mic experience. So it'll tune out background wind noise, it'll help bring up the levels and balance out the sound. And you can do some on-device editing with that audio clip and mastering and stuff like this. It's super niche, super, super like, this is a device for creators.
Yeah,
but like even the creators, they've already got that. Like if they're doing this kind of thing, they've already got the setup and they're not paying a monthly fee for it. So like, what?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why?
And it also means you're then locked into your, I mean, your phone, everyone's trying to get a subscription service. This is the weirdest subscription service offering I've ever seen.
Yeah, that's so bizarre.
Expensive one.
Yeah, it's a lot of money.
You use that a lot to justify a $5. That's the same price as Disney Plus. You know, like
I know which one I want.
Yeah. Oh. Also, they have brought in the subject of video streaming. They've brought Bravia Core to mobile now as well. Bravia Core's on their high end TVs. It's like gives you kind of a kind of filtered view of content optimized for the kind of features that Sony likes to push. So like its HDR standards and its Dolby support and all that kind of stuff. So you now can do that on the device because it's spec'd for all of their stuff. You know, their 360 reality audios in there, all of that.
Cool. Okay, let's move on and talk about the other Sony phone in brief. So they also announced the Sony Xperia 10.4. It's worth noting they did not announce an Xperia 5.4, the compact version of the flagship. So we had heard in leaks before that one of the Xperias had been cancelled. That one, I guess. So maybe it's going to turn up in 6 months. I wouldn't put it past Sony, but I think it's probably fair to say they have killed their small phone as well, and we can add it to the big pile of small phones that nobody bought. But we have the Xperia 10.4. So this is it's such great contrast in price. I love that they, outside of Japan, released two phones, and one of them is a third of the price of the other one. So this is very much a mid-ranger. It's really right around the same pricing as the Google Pixel 6a. What's confusing is they haven't announced an actual price for the phone they're launching next month. They've announced an approximate price, which is approximately €499, £429.
They're like, we haven't quite decided yet. We're gonna see how it goes over the next few weeks.
I hope it comes in at like $492, something really, really,
something
obscure.
Really obscure. Yeah,
official price.
I assume this is some ultra precise attempt to be ultra precise instead of getting around the fact that often pricing in Europe actually varies by market. And so what they probably mean is it's $429 in the UK, and in Europe it's around $499, but it might be €10 more in Germany than it is in France. Okay. But everyone else just announces the cheapest price they've got, and Sony wanted to flag that it might vary. So I suppose I should, you know, give them kudos for that rather than knock the weird wording. But yeah, this is, again, they haven't changed a huge amount from last year this time. It looks very, very similar. It's like the last one, got the slightly odd IP65/68 dust and water resistance rating, which I promise does make sense. I can't remember off the top of my head how it makes sense, but you have to, it's 65 and 68 are technically slightly different ratings, and 68 is for different things, not just more of the same as 65. So it does make sense to have both of the slash.
If you go to really techadvisor.com, you'll find the What is an IP rating article, which will explain everything.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, I don't know. There's not a huge amount else to say here. It's got triple cameras. It's the
colors. Same as
last one, isn't it? I do like the colors, actually. That's fair. The fact they've gone colorful, because they usually go so plain and boring with these.
Yeah. We'll probably just get the black one in the UK, because that's how it played out last time, I think.
But there are white, green, and purple ones. Mm. And I'm a sucker for a purple phone. I think this is a good purple. I like it. But I like the green. I actually really like that punchy green they've gone for.
What did you think of the purple on the One Mark 4 whilst we're here?
Oh, I didn't notice the purple One Mark 4.
Unassumingly like dark grey.
I
didn't realize it was purple at first.
That doesn't sound like a good purple.
No. It's the lightest 5G phone, I think they said. That was their hook with the 10 Mark 4.
Yeah, you mentioned this earlier. Is that counting apples?
Is in the light?
The iPhone SE and the minis are both pretty light. Brilliant. Phones.
Maybe they said Android phone? I don't know.
I could believe this could be the lightest 5G Android phone. I'd be really impressed if it was lighter.
I don't know if it's on the site. It's definitely in the presentation is where they said it. So that was the quote I kind of picked up on. So yeah, maybe it's just rubbish.
Yeah.
Absolutely rubbish.
I'm a little suspect of that. Because it's not that small a phone either. It's not like those are very, very, very dinky.
Whereas the screen size?
6 inches. Mm. So it's not... It is smallish, which I guess in a way, presumably this is kind of, we're talking about them canceling the 5.4. In a way, this is them kind of fusing the 5 and the 10. This is small, around the size the 5 was, but with the less powerful specs of the 10 series. So I guess it's them consolidating those two. I can't help but, for a company that already only made 3 phones, the fact that they now make 2 phones does feel a bit like the writing's on the wall.
Hey, don't forget about the Pro I.
Yeah.
if you thought the top spec One Mark 4 was expensive, the Pro I starts there as well.
Yes, that's true.
With last year's hardware.
I should also caveat, they do make more phones than that, just they don't come out outside of Japan. They do kind of have a few other cheaper models that launch
like
in Japan.
Ace, I think, in Japan.
Yeah,
that's popular.
That's right.
Yeah,
they just never come out anywhere else.
What I was curious about, I know as part of this rebranding, globally anyway, they released like the L4 a couple of years ago.
Oh, yeah.
And then I reviewed that. I mean, it wasn't particularly great for the price, because it was so much great competition. But then I think they've just stopped releasing that. There's no word on them releasing like a true budget phone anymore.
The number of times I've had conversations with Sony reps about them like rethinking their mobile approach, and they're going all premium this year, or they're going to do like, you know, just 3 phones this year. And they're always very optimistic. Like, they do clearly want to succeed. Like, they're trying, but then it seems like they don't then follow through with like a clear plan. And that's where it falls apart.
I feel bad for them in the mid-range space, because we're talking about the 6A kind of having an IP rating and that being kind of relatively rare, and kind of that showed this kind of some element of like a syncing approach between Google and Samsung and to some extent Apple in how they approach the mid-range market. But the thing is, Sony did that first. And really, one of the things about the Xperia 10s was for a while they were unique because they had this line of having kind of flagship features like an IP rating and you know, a couple other bits, but bringing those to the lower end of the market and then compromising in kind of core performance and stuff like that. It was the USP of the Xperia 10s fundamentally, but now Samsung, Apple and Google all pretty reliably offer the exact same thing. And it's hard to see what then the 10 brings to the market that no one else does.
And also the other thing with, you know, we often talk about how there's less competition in the mid-range market in the US, and Sony sells its flagships in the US. It doesn't sell the mid-ranges in the US. Mm. So if anywhere was going to do well for the 10.4, it would probably be the US.
Yeah.
And yet they're not selling it there.
The US mid-range market remains this fascinating, like, open goal, waiting for literally any company.
No one's
to try and put the ball in the net, but they refuse on, I don't know, point of principle or something.
I should just say that, just going back to the one Mark IV, that's, it's coming out in June in the UK, but then not until the start of September in the US.
Oh, really?
It was a really strange decision. Oh. I know that obviously it's like no priority in the US market, but why would you release it at all if it's going to be so delayed again?
That's at least more concrete than last year, where they were like summer, and then it kind of trickled out in various countries just willy nilly. Like there was no rhyme or reason to which one.
Last year, there was pretty much a full 6 month gap, right, between announcement and release. Yes,
it was so mad.
They're closing it. Let's talk about ZTE briefly before we wrap things up for today, because in any other week, I think the ZTE Axon 40 announcement might well have been one of the main things we wanted to chat about on the show, because it is interesting. So ZTE announced the Axon 40 series, which includes the third gen of their under-display selfie camera. So they were the first to do this, and they are probably the best. Sorry, Samsung, and they have gotten better yet again. There are two phones. I spoke the other week when I was talking about this that we were expecting three phones, but again, I was wrong. Sorry. There are two, but they have managed to shift their naming structure again. So last year there was an Axon 30 and an Axon 30 Ultra. Now there's an Axon 40 Pro and an Axon 40 Ultra, but there's no regular Axon 40.
Because that'd be too easy.
That'd be too easy. Last year, the under-display camera was on the regular model, but not on the Ultra. This year, the under-display camera is in the Ultra, not in the Pro.
We were talking about this, weren't we?
And not in the non-existent regular model. So, I don't know. They're clearly changing tack, you know, rapidly as they try and figure out how to get this lineup out into the market in a compelling way.
I think it speaks to their confidence of their on-display camera tech. Like last year, they weren't too sure whether it was going to be quite as good as the competitors, whereas now they're like, God, we're so far ahead of everybody else. Let's make a bit more money off this.
Kind of, again, open goal situation. Like no one else is doing this. They kind of have free reign. With the three, I think you reviewed the Axon 30, Lewis, is that right?
Yes.
And they'd already figured out how to match the pixel density with the camera portion with the rest, right? So I assume all that's improved now is picture quality, because that's always the thing that suffers with these mesh systems, right?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it was basically undetectable last year. If you really looked, you could see a rough little circular outline where it was, but I imagine that's probably non-existent this year. Obviously the marketing shows that there's no camera, but it's marketing, so yeah. We'll have to wait and see on that one.
I called Huawei out in the past for disappearing the bezels on their phones. Literally, it was no bezel. They just screen right to the edge. I was like, that's not how any phone looks.
They usually do it by having like a black thing on the screen, so they can just they can just hide the bezels like that, can't they? And they just but the under display camera was really impressive, especially when I compared it to, like, I was looking at those from the Fold and stuff like that, and I just couldn't believe how much better it was. And
the fold was
terrible. Like, absolutely dismal. So yeah, I mean, if there's any company that's going to get an under display camera right, it's ZTE.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting, Toddy. You made the point. You kind of figured the main enhancements they talk about would be to actual image quality from the under display thing. Mm. Actually, in a way, what they've been at least typing up is that it's even more invisible still.
Oh no, that's bad in my book. That's worrying.
Yeah, they've now I assume this helps with the image quality as well, but what they've added now is there's a new dedicated display chip called the UDC Pro chip, which is at least in part designed to maintain that uniformity in pixel density. So that's kind of what that is there for, to specifically, we've seen phones with dedicated display chips, but this is one that's dedicated to that tiny bit of the display.
So like 200 pixels.
Yeah. Just to keep it running like the others. And you can see they've got sort of imagery from the presentation where they're just like highlighting the two bits of the screen next to each other. You just cannot tell the difference zoomed in as they can get. So they seem to be emphasizing that they're perfecting that, and image quality is still maybe the thing they don't want to draw the most attention to. I've seen a couple of people who've managed to get their hands on sort of a Hong Kong unit earlier, or tried out in China and taken selfies with it. And the tone I've seen from people trying it out for themselves is, again, better, but it's still not
it's
quite
not a standard camera. Yeah.
Yeah. There's still a softness to it, which is still going to be the drawback for so many.
I think in front of a camera, there's always going to be something in the way.
Exactly. Yeah. We were talking about the iPhone kind of future earlier in terms of both lightning and then talking about their upcoming pill and punch hole thing. But there was some speculation this week about when they would adopt under display cameras. And basically Ross Young, who works in the display industry, was basically, I think, predicting that the pros would adopt it in 2025.
So is that 16, iPhone 16?
The iPhone 16 Pros, yeah. And that the regular models would get it in the 17s. That's how long he thought it would take for Apple to hit the point where this tech was A, good enough, but also, to be fair, affordable enough for them to mass produce, because that is the other factor there. Hmm. So it's not just a question of quality, but still, there was this idea that even with this kind of latest version, still for Apple, we're 3 years off the point where they might be willing to put it in a phone.
I mean, I would pitch even longer just based on the fact we still don't have in-display Touch ID.
Like... Yes, I gotta be honest, yeah. I think 2025 might be optimistic.
Yeah. Oh,
yeah. Yeah. By that estimate, they're going to have foldables out before they have under-display cameras.
Sure, yeah.
Yeah. Because then would Apple... Would it try and put all its like Face ID sensors under the display as well?
Oh yeah, 100%. They're not going to get rid of Face ID.
His prediction was we will see Face ID go under the display in 2024, I think. I can't remember exactly. Right. But Face ID goes underneath first and you just get a single punch hole. And then a year or two later, the selfie camera goes under the display.
And then they'll spin it as the first ever phone to ever do that.
Yeah, exactly. It'll be groundbreaking. But that makes sense because Face ID, presumably, you don't need the Face ID to be pixel perfect in the same way. As long as it doesn't break the security side of it, I'm sure they can figure out ways to make that work under the display. Yeah. But no one wants... Apple must be so terrified of putting out an iPhone that everyone says, like, worst selfie camera ever in an iPhone, you know?
Yeah.
Do we know, with the Axon 40 range, are we going to see them in Europe or in the UK or in the US or anywhere else?
Yeah, so the Ultra is on track for a global launch, which I think the current ones you can buy in the US. They're not available like from carriers or anything, but you know, you could go to the ZTE website in the US and buy one. So I think that would be the same here. So the Ultra with the under-display camera will be getting a global launch. It looks like the Pro maybe won't be. At least there's been no confirmation of the Pro going international, which again makes sense because the Pro doesn't have that unique selling point to it. The Pro is just another pretty nice looking Android slab phone. It's got 144 hertz refresh rate, so that's still relatively unique. But it's a Snapdragon 870, so it's not top of the line performance wise otherwise, and so the balance of specs are a little odd. The Ultra is an 8 Gen 1. One thing to note, the Ultra is like, it's a 6.8-inch display, which sounds enormous, but it's better than the 6.9-inch display they used on last year's. So this is them making it compact.
Pocketable,
But I think that's a good move. I hope it keeps going that way, because,
They should have just called it 6.79. It sounds so much less when it's 6.7. Yeah, there's a barrier there, isn't there? It's like...
The 99p threshold.
Uh-huh. Exactly.
I'm really curious to see what the design is like in person, because it's like, it looks kind of like just like the Moto Edge 30 series right now.
Images.
It looks a lot like it did last year. It doesn't look that different.
Very similar.
Even the camera bump on the back is almost identical to what it looked like last year. It's just
very Spartan, kind of simple.
Yeah. I like it. I think it's a really nice look.
Yeah, it's sleek. It's not eye catching. No. In a way, like, I don't think it does anything really unique or like, oh wow, this phone's beautiful. But if you want something that's a bit understated and just looks like a nice phone, I think it does that.
The 30 well. Ultra was one of my favorites of last year. It's got a place in my heart, the design of that phone.
This has also brought back the other kind of selling point they have behind the on-display camera, having brought up the camera module, is triple 64 meg rear cameras.
That was also my favorite thing about it.
Yeah. including a 64 meg periscope with OIS, which, you know, is pretty high megapixel for a periscope.
So yeah, it's going to be actually a good one.
Yeah,
imagine that.
Yeah, be intrigued.
They did a really good job with their camera tuning last year as well. Like, there was very kind of similar colored temperature and kind of between the three lenses. So I'm hoping for that very much.
I remember being very surprised by your review of the 30 Ultra, because my view of it was probably they've just thrown specs at this, but they won't know what to do with it. They don't, you know, they have Nubia, so they're good at gaming phones and performance on that side, but they don't really have any models out where I'd really rate them as like one of the best camera companies around. So I was very surprised that actually from your review, it really did look like the 30 Ultra actually delivered. I don't know if I'd say it's one of the best camera phones on the market, but it seemed really, really good.
I think it really surprised me. The most affordable ones in our best camera phone chart at the time, because it was surprisingly impressive what you could do for the money.
Cool. So I'm sure we will revisit the Axon 40 Ultra when we get one in, because we are going to be getting one for review. But I think given the timing, I think it's a July global release. So I imagine we'll be getting our review unit somewhere around there. So it might be a little while till we can talk about that again, but we'll definitely be chatting about that in the future to kind of talk about how that under display camera really holds up once we've gotten our hands on it. Cool. Well, let's call it. This has been a bumper episode. There has been a lot to talk about. We will be back same time, same place next week. We will get to talk about the OnePlus launch that's coming out next week. And the Huawei launch, of course. Yeah. And the other thing is, they mentioned last week, there is one more launch for this week, which is the global launch of Honor's Magic 4 series is tonight in London. So it's just a bit too late for us to talk about on this week's show, but we may return to Magic 4 stuff next week to cover that again. So yes, thank you, Lewis, Toddy, Anne, and Iron for joining me this week. Thank you to everyone who has been watching and listening. And a special thank you to Nass in the YouTube comments, who decided to compliment my Arsenal t-shirt. Very much appreciated. For those of you who don't know, there's a very big game tonight against Tottenham. I'm going to be in the pub getting very stressed and drunk.
Very nice.
So I'm off to do that. Thank you, everyone, and bye for now.
Bye.
See ya.